Like everyone here, I should start by saying that I'm very pleased to be here and to give this seminar, except that my pleasure is tempered by the fact that the reason I'm here is that there was no one else who would do it. And so I decided to talk about experiments I didn't run, using methods I don't quite understand, with results that I don't really know what they mean. Okay, so I will talk a bit about the methodology of calcium imaging, and then I'll cover three types of techniques. The first one, very briefly, is the work that Gideon Rothschild did with Adi Mizrahi and me. This has been presented here again and again, so I'll say just a few words about it. And then I'll show two other types of approaches to the use of calcium imaging. The first one is going to coarser resolution, imaging populations of neurons. And the last one is imaging of subcellular, at the subcellular level, signals that come from single spines. Both of these have been done with people from the lab of Arthur Konert, and he is really the major contributor to this seminar. So why calcium? So why are we interested in calcium? We are really interested in electricity, not with calcium, usually. So calcium enters neurons as part of the electrical activity, and there are, for some reason I don't quite understand, there are some pretty good ways of reading the level of calcium. Okay, so it can serve as a replacement for electricity, which is in many ways harder to measure. Now, once you figure out that, and once you have the right dye, there are only two simple technicalities. The first of them is to put the dye into the neurons, and the other one is, since this is done with light, you need to shine the light on the tissue and get back the fluorescence. The problem with the calcium indicators is that they are water soluble, so they can't get through the membrane. You can't just put them in the extracellular fluid and expect them to go into neurons. And what people are doing today is to use two types of solutions. The first of them is to get with an electrode to the neuron, and then use the electrode to fill the neuron with the dye. The advantage, as you will see at the end of this talk, is that you can get a lot of dye into the neuron. The disadvantage is that basically you can do it one neuron at a time. And the other technique is the bolus loading. This is a trick that actually I looked up today. So it turns out that it was invented 30 years ago by Roger Fier. What he realized is that you can take these calcium-sensitive molecules, which have charges on them, and cover the charge with chemical entity that masks the charge, and so you get something that is uncharged, and this thing can go through the membrane from the extracellular environment into the neurons. And then you have enzymes into the neuron that cut these additional chemical groups, and you get back the calcium-sensitive dye inside the neuron. Okay. This has been used in a number of ways, but the modern protocol has been developed in the Connaught lab. This is the PNAS paper that describes the methodology, how to actually use these ideas in vivo. Okay, other groups develop the technique in vitro. And the initial great success in not technical but scientific was a paper that appeared, an article that appeared in Nature in 2005, where this has been used to map functionally map primary visual cortex. And this method has been used extensively since. So we have a way to put a dye into a lot of neurons, and then we have to read to excite and read the signal. So one way to do it is to shine light through an optical fiber and read back the light through the optical fiber. The advantage is that this is very simple. The disadvantage is that it doesn't give you much the single neuron resolution that we would like to have for some of the work that I will talk about here. But again, I will show you data using this technique which are useful for understanding or maybe for measuring a population type of activities in the brain. The method that's usually used is two-photon imaging. So the idea with two-photon imaging is the following. You want to excite the dye so that it emits light. Usually you do it with a wavelength that's a bit shorter than the light that will be eventually emitted. The idea with two-photon microscopy is that if you shine a light that's intense enough, this jump, initial jump, can be done by the electron eating two photons. Each one of them has half the energy that's necessary to excite it. And half the energy means double the wavelength. So you're actually using a light at a wavelength that's much longer than the one that you will eventually get out of the tissue. And this has a lot of advantages. So again, this has a very long history. The idea, the theoretical idea is from 80 years ago. The first useful two-photon microscope is from about 20 years ago. As I mentioned before, the applications, actual applications for studying cortical tissue are from about 6 or 7 years ago. So here's an illustration. There's a dye here that is excited by this wavelength, and you can shine this wavelength and get the fluorescence. Here you have you use a wavelength that twice the wavelength, and you can't see the excitation light, but you can see the fluorescence that occur only at the place where the beam is at its strongest. Okay, so there's a small spot of fluorescence out here. One of the advantages of this method is that since this reaction, this excitation, occurs only at the location where the beam is at its strongest, you can actually collect all the photons that get out of the tissue, and you know that all of them come from that place. The advantage, again, is that you get a lot of photons. However, the fact that you actually excite only one spot at a time means that you have to scan the tissue. You have to move the laser beam around. And this is usually done with mirrors, but mirrors are slow. So if you want to take a beam and scan this resolution, relatively large field of view, you get scanning rates that are today maybe not 1 hertz, but a few tens of hertz. 15 hertz or 20 hertz, and this is too slow for some of the signals that we want. So part of the problem today in developing this method is to find faster scanning. One of the last bit of work that I will show you was actually using acousto-optical deflectors, which are much, much faster, but they have their own disadvantages. Okay, so I'll go fast to the first application of calcium imaging. Imaging of multiple single neurons in small networks. So for that purpose, I don't want to say we use, it's Gidon who used bolus loading to get dye into many neurons, two photon microscopy to excite and get the signals back, and this is how it looks like. So you have here, Jonathan, can you turn off the spotlight? You get here the many neurons that have been loaded with dye, and you present sound here, and you get something. Okay, this type of calcium transient. Now, what do these calcium transients tell us? As I said, we are usually interested in electrical responses and not in the calcium level, although calcium level by itself is a very important factor in neurons, so I can imagine people measuring calcium in order to know what the calcium level is. Okay, but we measure calcium because we want to know what the electricity is. So it is commonly assumed that these big jumps in the calcium occur because there was a spike. And then we can use the calcium transients to indicate the times of the spikes. There is some imprecision that is due to the fact that the rise time is much slower than the spike time, and the fact that they have a very long decay time. However, this can be verified directly, so this is taken, taken from the work of Gidon. There's an electrode here. He was recording this neuron in a loose patch configuration, so he just gets close to the membrane but doesn't break it. And then you get these spikelets from the neuron, and at the same time he imaged the tissue, so you get the calcium from that same neuron. At the end, when he finished, he broke the seal, the membrane here, and verified that the neuron gets filled with the dye that is inside the electrode. And you can see relatively nicely the fact that the transients occur at the time in which there were spikes. Okay, the red spots are the results of an automatic algorithm that was working on the calcium signal and was trying to identify the time of these fast transients. It worked reasonably well, not perfectly. One thing that you should be aware of is that at this time scale, these things look like single spikes.
What
but
is the time scale?
This is, I think this is 5 seconds. Gidon, do you remember?
No, this is about 2 seconds.
2 seconds, okay, but it's seconds.
Each trace is 10 seconds.
Yeah.
Each full trace, there
are
3 traces.
Yeah. So anyway, it's a few seconds worth of, it's many seconds worth of data, and these things are sometimes burst. They more than one spike. The size of the calcium transient is roughly monotonically dependent on the number of spikes in the burst, but you can't really read how many spikes there were from the size of the calcium of the calcium transient. So this is one thing, and the other one is that there are some calcium changes, like this slow thing that we don't really understand and that we just neglect. Okay, so they are not part of the analysis. Now, here's the main result. I mean, the experiment was done in order to get something that looks like here. So, what you have... wait. There are 5 neurons here in this plot. And these are calcium signals triggered on sound event, on sound presentations in these 5 neurons. Okay, and we have here responses... So all the response on a single row were recorded at the same time. These are 5 different neurons that were imaged simultaneously. The tone here, for example, was 16 kilohertz at 55 dBs level of 55 dB SPL. Neuron number 2 emitted large transients. Most of the time when the 16 kilohertz was played, it did not responded much to the other frequencies. This neuron number 1, for example, the other neurons did not respond much to 16 kilohertz. Okay, 45 kilohertz was about did not evoke responses at all at neuron number one. It evoked some responses in the other neurons, and so on and so forth. So you get simultaneous recordings of responses from many neurons, and these bars here are a measure of the size of the cancer transients.
Each line here
is different trial. Colors correspond along this axis. All the blue trace here, recorded at the same time.
So when you send the vertical bars, is the average?
Gidon used is the integral underneath the beginning of the transient.
There are three trials with interval response.
Yeah, so most of them here are at zero, and one of them is the pink one. Okay. So these are yes.
It is more dichotomic than I would expect
because if you have a spike or you don't, if you look at the spike or the variability,
you not see like the example that Chaim mentioned, the second from the top right, okay? Four with excellent response, four trial, and three with nothing.
And
you have many examples like this that it is not continuous variability, but
This is exactly what you expect. Either you had a spike or not. When you had a spike, you have a transient, and when you don't have a spike, you don't.
A burst.
It's about the same.
So whenever you look at electrophysiology, there was a burst of three spike or five spike or two, but.
So you got a lot. You got large bursts.
No.
Also, the responses are because you get you always think typical best results. It's usually the responses are null or something. Okay. In a previous slide, we quantified this kind of failures and things like that. Actually, the problem we have are with cases like that one. Okay, this one where you have a sort of continuous. Levels of calcium. Okay, I think these are the hard to understand, or the more complicated to understand.
Again, what's the sample scale here?
This is sound presentation, so it's 100 milliseconds. What? 50 milliseconds. Okay, so you end up with something that looks like that. This is one field of view. Okay, there were here something like 15 neurons from which these transients could be well identified by a quality criterion that Gidon developed. Some of them did not respond at all, some of them did respond. You have here two nearby neurons. These are these bars that indicate the size of the responses, so you see nicely that they responded to about the same range of frequencies. Okay, and you have also cases like this one. Again, this is a different field of view with different set of neurons, and here you have two nearby neurons that respond to frequency ranges which are completely non-overlapping. Okay, so there's a lot of variability in the frequency tuning of the different neurons, and then we got plots like this. Here each dot represents one neuron. These, the X and Y axis, are the caudo-rostral distance and the ventro-dorsal distance of the location of the neuron. So this is space. These are neurons in space. And if you just take the distance along the rostro-caudal axis, which should be also the tonotopic axis, and you plot the best frequency of the neuron as a function of its distance along this axis, you see that over about 100 micron of distance along the mouse auditory cortex, you have, first of all, very large distribution of best frequencies and not much of a gradient. Okay? When we look at longer distances, so in this case, Gidon had two injections and imaged the neurons at one injection and then at the second one, then over longer distances, in this case a few hundreds of microns, 300 or 400 microns, you can already see a tonotopic axis. So the main conclusion of that paper was this, okay, the fact that if each candy here represents a neuron with a certain base frequency, there is some order and some disorder. Remarkably, in the same issue of Nature Neuroscience, there was back-to-back with our paper, there was another paper using exactly the same techniques and reaching exactly the same conclusions from the lab of Patrick Canold in University of Maryland College Park with Shiav Sharma, the auditory person.
Okay. Can you yes. go back to the slide? So the slope here is consistently the same as the slope.
No, it's not. The slope here is essentially it actually goes in the other direction. But you expect, if you look at a very small part, if you will take 100 microns here, okay, and try use only these points and try to pass a line through them, then the slope will be very, very different from the overall slope, because you have a much higher variability relative to the signal. So to some extent, the two examples can be fit, can be sort of hand waved together by saying that here you see the slope because you have much larger range of x values of distances along the cortical surface. Okay. I'm not sure that there may be some variability between animals. Okay, that's not need not be the only.
So that's the slope which goes the other direction is simply noise.
Yeah, it should be only noise. Okay, so from here I want to go to the larger scale, and I want to tell you about a study in which we recorded population signals. So in order to make a kind of transition between the data I just showed you and the larger scale data, the one thing I would like to mention is the fact that another thing that Gideon did with his data is to calculate correlations. And these results are also interesting. Measuring correlations with his signal is not easy, but Gideon is now improving, and there will be more data coming out of it. What I did was, in a way, it can be seen as just instead of recording the single neuron and calculating correlation, just to see the overall effect of the correlation by looking at the average activity of many neurons. So here, what we did was to use a method that was developed by Helmut Adelsberger a few years ago. He attaches a fiber optic. He used bolus loading, so there are many, many neurons filled up with dye. And then he puts an optical fiber on the surface of the cortex, or a little bit deeper. And he uses a laser to excite the dye, and through the same fiber he reads out the fluorescence and a somewhat longer wavelength. This turns out to result in a single signal out of this population of neurons that presumably reflects the activation of thousands of neurons that see the laser light. So it's a kind of multi-unit activity signal. Presumably it represents only spikes and not local field potentials or things like that, because local field potentials and things like that presumably do not produce the calcium signals that are seen with this type of loading of the neurons. Okay, so is there correlated activity of many neurons? The answer is obviously yes. Okay, this is what you see. The time scale here again. Okay, I kept the time scales. Okay, 5 seconds. So what you get are relatively large transients. Each one of these transients presumably represents the activity of hundreds to thousands of neurons underneath the the fiber. The way that they calibrated it in the Connaught lab was to take the same tissue that has been stained, cut it, making slices out of it, and then put glutamate on it so that you get transients that are presumably due to all the neurons firing. Okay, and then they can count how many neurons were stained by looking at the with the microscope through the tissue, and so they, by taking the ratio between the total number of neurons by measuring the total number of neurons and how large would be the activity of when the transient when you activate all of them, they can calculate how many neurons approximately had to be activated in order to produce these type of transients. So you get these calcium transients. So obviously, here, this is an anesthetized mouse. In a moment, I'll show you what happens when it's awake. Here, okay. So these spontaneous calcium transients have actually structure and properties that depend on the state and the age of the animal. So the first paper that the Adelsberger paper in 2005 reported these waves in young animals. This is a recording from an animal that should be about 20 days old, so it's not a neonate, but it's relatively young. It's anesthetized, there's a certain rate of events. When it's adult and it's anesthetized, the rate of event is slightly higher. With awake adults, you get much higher events that are smaller and have some simpler structure. Okay, in the anesthetized animals, these transients seem to be composed from a lot of sub things. Okay, in the awake animals, they don't have this substructure. I don't know what this means. You can calculate the autocorrelation of the starting time of these sub events. In the young animals, there is some periodicity here. These things appear at about every 7 seconds. Okay, in the adult ones, this periodicity is lost. And in the anesthetized animal, they tend to appear in clusters. Okay, so the autocorrelation has a big peak at the beginning. Whatever. What really interested us is the sound responses to sound of these things. So here there's a noise presented, and shortly after the noise, we have a transient coming out of the tissue. It turned out that these transients have two parts. The first part is a very fast thing with a latency that's consistent with the spiking responses of the neurons. And then later you have a slow and a larger slow response. Okay, so this is one example of an individual transient. Here are many examples like that, okay, with the initial transient followed by the fast transient followed by the slow one. Okay, the initial transients have latencies that, again, I told you they are consistent with the spiking responses. So here what I did was to plot many different animals. For each animal, I used all the transients that occurred, all the sound presentation that occurred when the calcium signal was at baseline. Okay, so I could see the full transient. And this is the range of latencies of the sound evoked transients. Okay, most of them have shortest latencies of 20-30 milliseconds, okay, which is what you would expect from the spiking responses. Okay, what's really interesting is the late response. The late responses are not consistent with anything that is well described in auditory cortex. So first of all, these late responses are pretty similar to the spontaneous transients. Okay, this is one example of two transients from the same animal. Christina Greenberger did here was to measure a few of them and the lifetime of the evoked transients and of the slow part of the transients. What she measured was the time from here to here. Okay, so this is the rise time of the slow transients, the width of the of the slow transients and the decay time, they look pretty much the same across the population. These transients are stimulus specific. So here, for example, we used a lot of different frequencies. What you see here are all the responses to 15 kilohertz. Okay, and then this is the red line is the average, and it's plotted here. And around it, you see responses to other frequencies. So it looks like this is one animal, this is a different animal, that's a third animal. Okay, so it looks like these transients, these slow transients, when we evoke them with sound, are frequency tuned. And the tuning here is sort of consistent. Sorry, I'm going now to slide back. Sort of consistent with the fact that you see here a lot of neurons with about, one octave range of frequencies. Okay, so the tunings are about one octave wide, or slightly more than that, and this is consistent with the major variability between best frequencies at a thing that's 100 microns, which is about the size of the spot that we recall from here.
But if you look, so there is also an early transient here, right?
Yeah.
What is the tuning of that?
And they are co-tuned. The early transient and the slow transient always come together. So the implication would be that it's the early transients that ignite the late one. Okay, now the slow component, but not the fast one, turns out to depend on the level of calcium at sound presentation. So this is a lucky case in which there were a lot of sound presentations, all of which occurring at the time in which the calcium signal was at baseline. Okay, but here, yeah. So the blue traces are presumably, the blue ones are spontaneous transients, and the red ones are sound evoked.
The red
one
are the sound. Okay,
yeah.
So to show us the early response.
Here you can't see it. It's plotted in black, but you can't see it because of the time scale. Okay, the early response, it's this black bar. But it occurs at about 30 milliseconds after sound onset, and here the scale is 10 seconds, so you can't really see it. However, if the sound gets presented at a time in which the calcium signal was at a very high value, there's essentially no late transient. Okay, there's a decay here that presumably comes from the fact that there is a transient to start with. Okay, so if I measure now the size of a late transient as a function of the fluorescence level at stimulation time, I see that the early transient here in black depends a little bit, but not much, on the level of fluorescence at sound onset, but the late transient depends a lot. Okay, in fact, it looks like, I didn't put the traces here, but it looks like the late transient has a saturation level. Every time you ignite it, it will get to the same level exactly. Not exactly, approximately. Okay, the last thing that we did was to measure electricity at the same time that we measured calcium. Now, we couldn't put an electrode for technical reasons, so we did the best thing we could do easily, and this is to measure electrocorticogram across the whole of the brain. Okay, the mouse is so small that with everything that needs to be put on the top of the skull for the fiber recording, it's very difficult to put other stuff, so we just could put one fiber at the front and one wire at the front and one wire at the back, and record the overall electrocorticogram out of that. This is presented here in brown. Okay, now the electrocorticogram in these animals also show up in down states. So here, for example, you get, this is an up state, you have a large fluctuation, and then that's a down state of the electrocorticogram, no activity. Okay, that's an up state, and this is a down state, there's no activity. So from the electrocorticogram, you can read out something that we call the global up state of the brain, and this corresponds corresponds pretty nicely with the up and down state of the quantum signal. Usually, what you see is something like that. The electrocortical ground going to an up state, and shortly later, a couple of hundred of milliseconds later, you get a spontaneous calcium transient. Okay, rarely you have things like that. There was a global up state, but no calcium transients. And from time to time, you had a sound that evoked a calcium transient, and then the global up, the electrical up states come up. Okay, here are a few other cases like that. Okay, there's the calcium. Chaim, you see again, that's the initial transient and then the late one. And you have here, slightly after the initiation of the sound, you get the big wave, the electricity, which comes up and presumably represents some sort of global activity state of the whole brain. So the last thing that the people in that Christina Greenberger and Helmut Asperger did was to use to ask whether they could trigger the these late waves in a different way. They used a mouse which has channel rhodopsin in layer 5 pyramidal cells. Okay, and then this is a mouse in which they recorded sound evoked responses, and also they put light, and they get also these, they get the something that looks like the calcium, the spontaneous calcium transient, which is evoked by the, or the slow calcium component, which is evoked by the light. Okay, so that's the averages. Okay, and again, you can measure the rise time and the duration and decay time, and they look pretty much like the spontaneous and the evoked slow transients. Okay, so what did we see? We have a late slow response component that represents something that's different from what we usually do when we record activity in auditory cortex. It is related to the upstates of the cortical network. It can be locally evoked by appropriate acoustic stimuli. Okay, and it also can locally evoked by activating layer 5 pyramidal neurons. What I didn't show you, but the data exists there. The people who did the experiments left the lab, and it will take time before it's published. These transients can propagate on the cortex and also the subcortical structure. So you can put fibers in two places on the cortex, or in cortex and hippocampus, and then you can see the transients occurring at one location and shortly afterwards at a different location. And then...
You're talking about the calcium
transients. The calcium transients, yes. So what in addition to the fact that they encode the stimulus that was presented to the area, they might represent some sort of long-distance secure propagation of information, presumably from sensory cortices to throughout the brain. Okay, that's, these are all speculations. Okay, that needs much more work.
Basically,
so no, these recordings, they were not necessarily in layer 2, 3. They were usually at a depth slightly deeper.
Deeper than that?
Yeah, because again, you can push the fiber wherever you want. You can put the fiber in the hippocampus. So these recordings, again, there are a few thousands of neurons. Presumably, what you see is actually you sum up light from the whole of the whole column.
Eddie, I think I missed something. In the first part of the talk you showed, when you present the sound with a given frequency, you see a few spikes, maybe a burst.
Yeah.
Here you show it, maybe you don't understand it. When you present a sound, there is this 1 second activation or something.
Yeah.
And these are spikes.
These are presumably spikes.
Where are these spikes? Why didn't they see these spikes before?
That's a wonderful question. I don't know. I mean, when I saw these things...
But it's the same...
When I saw these things initially, it took me some time to realize that I actually don't understand them.
But
again, the idea is...
If it propagates to other regions, the calcium that propagates to other regions.
No.
It's through spikes that the problem
is. Presumably. Again, Chaim.
Or maybe I'm wrong.
Chaim, the current orthodoxy is that these calcium signals that are recorded when you do this bolus loading are always, they always represent spikes. Okay, I'm not the person to tell you whether this is completely true or not. At some point, I was looking at papers coming from Bill Ross's lab, looking at intracellular changes, release of calcium from intracellular stores, which seems to fit the time scale. This 1 second duration of these events, the people at Connaught Lab convinced me that this is presumably not the source of these potentials. They believe quite strongly, and they have some evidence that these are really spikes. What these may represent is the activity, a small rise in the firing rate of a lot of neurons. Okay, that would also be consistent with these large calcium effects, because this integrates the activity of many of thousands of neurons. But if you increase the, if you put one or two additional spikes for each neuron that's underneath the fiber, presumably you will get large stuff that looks like that. Yeah.
Won't you be against the
I will say something in a moment about that.
If you express GCAP in these cells and do the same technique, will you also expect to see this huge? And that's only somata from the local neuron?
I don't know.
But there should be the gate of box by now that the box by
I think there's, in slow time
fields,
all kinds of signals coming into the
code. Yeah, well, you know, for the fact that these are, in favor of the fact that these are electricities, the relationship between them and these global upstates of the EEG. Okay, you wouldn't expect that to happen if everything that you saw was only local activity, local activity in the network. But, okay, let's leave it at that. I mean, I'm not the person to grill on at this level of resolution. Yes.
Well, I just wanted to mention to you that on your Padilla paper, which came out with us, they claim that with OGB we have some threshold signals and some threshold signals, so it might be this is with OGB.
This is OGB, yeah. Okay. So the last bit I want to discuss is imaging from things that are even smaller than that are smaller than neurons. Okay, what we would like to know is the signal from spines. This is difficult because as you start to look on smaller and smaller things, you need to pump more and more energy into the tissue, so the tissue gets damaged. And then about a year ago, there was this paper coming out of the Connaught lab about what they did was to image signals from dendrites. So I want to go a little bit describe this paper shortly in order to emphasize what's different in the data that I will show you next. So first of all, here, as in the work that I did with the Connaught lab later, what you do is to get an electrode to a neuron, you patch it, and so it gets filled with dye. Now, this means that it gets filled with a lot of dye, okay? Much more than you can get with bolus loading. You get one neuron, but you see it really, really well. Okay, now, what they did was to image field of view that looked like that. So you get the dendrites in the field of view. And then they put region of interest here. These region of interest are about 10 microns long. Note this one, number 3. Here are the signals that come from the region of interest. This is visual cortex. So what they did was to show a visual stimuli, grating, moving in different directions. And what you see is that among all of these region of interest on different dendrites, only one of them, number 3, actually show calcium signals. What they show here is the electricity from the electrode that's attached to the cell body at the same time. Okay, they also hyperpolarize the neuron a little bit so there won't be any spikes. So what you see is only the sum threshold depolarization. Now, these signals are much smaller than the spike evoked transients in the soma. Okay, that's this is what I wanted the ID. That's what I wanted to say. When they get a spike in the soma, it makes signals that are that may be an order of magnitude larger than what they see here.
I was referring to axon.
Now, in this case, they had a dendrite that was recorded pretty stably, so they could take many, many, many images and average them, and so they could see some of the spines. And now they put smaller region of interest on top of this dendrite, and they see that the response, the largest response, occurs at the location in which they have the spine. Okay, from that, they conclude that these signals that they get from the dendrites are actually spine signals, but they don't have a direct evidence for that. Okay, and finally, the important result of using this technique is that you have hotspots which are sparsely located on the dendritic tree and have very best frequencies. Each hotspot has its own best frequency. Okay, and they are not excuse me. Orientation selectivity. Okay, and this made a lot of noise. Okay, for good reasons. Okay, that was the first time that there was a dendritic resolution mapping of inputs on cortical neuron in vivo. Okay, and what can be better than that? So, a couple of months after this paper came out, Arthur Conner told me that they actually can see spines and they want to do it in auditory cortex. So I helped them in setting up the auditory experiment. Direct visualization of spines requires some additional tricks. So one of them was the fact that they use now a very fast scanning technique. They have acousto-optical deflectors. These are things that act like lenses, but they are modulated by ultrasound. Okay, so they can shift the sound, the beam around according to the frequency of the sound that played to them. They also are very bad for the pulse widths. Okay, so one thing that the physicist who worked there did was to create a system. It needs two acoustic deflectors like that, that one of them fixes the distortion caused by the other, and then there's some complex optics on the way that does another thing, and all of that is highly secret. I don't know how it works. Also,
what are they trying to do now that they couldn't do before?
Okay, so what they do is they image now, instead of imaging at 30 hertz or 50 hertz or something like that, they image at 1000 hertz. Okay, and what this allows them is to actually at each point gets light for very short times, but it gets them 1000 times a second, and this turns out to be the crucial stuff. With that, the tissue remains healthy long enough so that they can actually image from it enough data to say something interesting.
Can explain again what's the relation between the
Okay, so here is the data. Okay, so this is standard two photon imaging. The scanning rate is 25 hertz, so it goes back to each point 25 per second, and each time it gets to that point, the laser beam remains there for 2 microseconds. Okay, so this is considered a long time. Okay, 2 microseconds. What you see here are the sound evoked transients. Okay, so at the beginning of the imaging, they play the sound, and you got a sound evoked transient. A few seconds later, they presented again a sound, and now there was already a significant amount of bleaching, so the signal size went down substantially. So they turned Oh, they turned the laser level up a bit. Okay, and then what you see is this brightening of a bit of the dendrite, and this represents photo damage. Okay, once they set, and there are no signals anymore. Okay, so within about 100 seconds, the tissue dies. Okay, and you can't see any more data from it. Okay, this is here. What they do is to sample at 1,000 Hz, so they go to into each point 1,000 times per second, but the dwell time is 50 nanoseconds. Okay, so it turns out that the distribution of the energy into many, many small packets is what keeps the tissue alive for longer. Okay, still, you can see here that the imaging here, I mean, in this experiment, it lasted about 4 minutes. Okay, that's about the time that you can image from the tissue.
Is about the amount of energy equal?
It will be about equal, yeah, comparable. Okay? But once you do that, you gain a lot of resolution. So note the bar scale here. This is 1 micron. So we have about 20 microns here. That's about order of the region of interest that they studied in the previous paper. Okay, and then look here at spine number one. So you can actually see the signal that seems to come from the spines. Okay. So the experiment is use an electrode to fill up the neuron, and then you select a bit of spine, 20 micron long, 10 micron long, something like that. You can see the spines. Okay, and then we play to them. In this case, it was noise, once, twice, three times, four times. This spine number three shows activity every time the noise was played, and a region of interest on the dendrite just connected to the spine has now much smaller signals. Spine number one, okay, and dendrite number one, again, the calcium signals are in the spines but not in the dendrite, and spine number two is silent. There's nothing there. Okay. This is layer 2-3, yeah. Now you need to work close to the surface. Okay. The signals are NMDA, represent activation of NMDA receptor. So here they recorded with MK801 in the electrode. And there are no more calcium transients to anything. When they evoke action potentials at the cell body, they get the signals, and no. Again, here it's 20, the delta F over F is 25%, before it was 0.1. Okay, so the signals from the spines are tiny relative to the signal that you get when you have a spike. Okay, this is back propagation, these are calcium signals that are due presumably to the back propagation of the spike in the dendrite. Okay?
But then you see they're not necessarily spines.
You see them as there was electricity that opened the calcium, and you see the calcium.
I know, but why in the spine they're bigger?
I can't tell you.
Why the time scale is so long?
That's the decay time. It's mostly determined by the decay time of the calcium transient, which is slow. Okay, here you see an example of a joint recording in the cell body. This is electricity from the cell body and the response to a noise burst. The response to the noise burst measured as electricity in the cell body and calcium in a spine. Okay, this was. This is part of the supplemental information. It was to show that the calcium signals occur at the right times to be related to the electricity measured in the soma. Okay, there's typically an electrical upstate that elicited in the neuron, and the calcium signal is much longer than the spikes would occur here. The calcium signal is much longer than the Like,
so this is sub-threshold.
This is sub-threshold. As in the GIA paper, the Shawai took great care to make sure that while he does the imaging, there are no spikes. Okay, it was easier in the auditory cortex than in the visual cortex. These neurons tend to have relatively low memory potential, and they spike very little, even when you test them in natural condition. Okay, yeah.
Why NMDA?
Because the calcium doesn't go through AMPA receptors. Okay, and that's the answer to the next question. Okay, if we put the MK801 into the neuron, we get about half the electricity. Okay, so the electricity goes down by a factor of about half. So it looks like the NMDA currents represent about half of the total charge flowing into the neuron. Okay, whatever that means. Okay, so now to the interesting stuff. So the big difference between the auditory cortex and the visual cortex in these experiments is the fact that the inputs are densely represented on the dendrites in contrast with the visual cortex. So what you see here is one neuron from which there are many different regions that have been imaged. And in the plot here you have the dendrite, and the dots represent spines that were activated by broadband noise. This is at a very low level, intermediate level, and high level. Okay, and you can see that in each one of these regions of interest, there are spines activated by broadband noise. Okay. Also, you can see that the number of spines goes up with sound level. Okay. These are all the regions of interest recorded from the neuron. Okay. They were not selected. And
but it's still it's one focal
plane, right? No, there are multiple focal planes and many regions of interest. Okay.
What is the difference between this and the visual?
In the visual cortex, you get these hotspots, which are the one per dendrite.
Per direction of movement.
No. There's also one per dendrite.
Well, it's very low sampling.
No, they looked at all of this region, and here you see all the hotspots on this neuron.
So one per branch?
One per branch, yes. Now,
you try using specific band frequency bands.
I will talk about it in a moment. Okay? So here, each
Is that
Well, again, in the GIA paper, they claimed that they see the hotspots only when there was a spine that got an input. Okay, so they claim that the hotspots represent the active spines. Okay, here they can actually see the active spine. Okay, and the claim here is that there are many spines that are activated by these stimuli. In each region of interest, you get spines that are activated by these stimuli, and many spines, not one. One thing that was interesting to me is that as we go from 20 dB to 0 dB SPL, the sound level, the number of spines that got activated about double. This is in one neuron, and this is over the population, but the amount of electricity didn't. Okay, so this is the polarization at the soma, and it's almost saturated already at the lower sound level. Okay, so there was a large increase in the number of spines. The increase in the number of spines that got activated was the same going from here to here and going from here to here when we increased the sound level, but the amount of voltage at the cell body increased a lot when we went to zero to minus 40. The minus 40 is below threshold, so there was no activation at all.
So would it be a substantial change in the number of spines, right?
Yeah, so the point... in the number of spikes?
In this case, the cell was hyperpolarized and there were no spikes.
Yeah.
But in older studies, as you know, this change in the level of dB is a substantial change in the number of spikes.
No, not necessarily. No, the dynamic range of neurons and electricity from neurons is very narrow. 20, 30 dB above threshold, and then you saturate. So this actually fits what we know from the spikes.
You mean there is not much change in the spikes from minus 20 to 0?
There wouldn't be much
there
change.
Be
yeah, if we wouldn't have the spikes.
How can the spines be corrected?
neuron. Okay, that's a result.
There is also inhibition here.
Like, well, yeah, I'll get back to that in a moment, okay? The other thing that we did, Udi, was to measure responses to different frequencies. So here again, there's a bit of spine. It's less than 10 micron long. Two active spines, two inactive spines. And when you look at the active spine, one of them responds only to frequencies of 29.7 kilohertz. The other one responds to a range of frequencies, but not to 22.7 kilohertz. Okay, so we had the range of tuning widths for the spines. This is the distribution of tuning widths. So tuning widths of zero means that they responded to a single frequency out of the frequency table that we used. Okay, so there's a lot of narrowly tuned. We just use one octave as our border between narrowly tuned and widely tuned, but this is of course arbitrary. And here you see examples of the distribution of tuning of spines on pieces of dendrites. So you have on the same dendrites, you have spines that are narrowly tuned and spines that are widely tuned. And those that are narrowly tuned, they're not necessarily narrowly tuned to the same frequency. On this spine, you have, and on the dendrite, this one is tuned to 22.7 kHz, this is to 22 kHz, and this is to 12 kHz. Okay, same here. I mean, you can get nearby spines that are tuned to a single frequency with no overlap between nearby spines. Of? The tuning of, I'll show you an example later. It's it depends a little bit on the sound level, but it's a bit less than an octave. It will be a bit less than an octave here. But it depends, I'll show you the example. Okay? And the lack of the heterogeneous distribution of the active spines in terms of the frequency tuning is illustrated here. So for example, here the, what Chawai did was to take each spine and then look at the different spines on the same dendrite. So this shows the distance in micrometer from the reference spine. And on the y-axis, it plots the frequency difference between the best frequencies of the two spines. So for example, this point represents a spine that was one quarter of the microns away from the reference spine, with the best frequency that's almost two octaves away from it. Okay, and if you
the lines
connect the reference spine with each one of the spines that are on the same dendrite. Okay, it was analyzed on the same dendrite. Okay, and what I did here was to summarize the range of distances between spines conditioned on the frequency difference between them. Okay, and the point is that these ranges are about the same for small differences and for large differences in these frequencies. Okay, and the last point that I want to show here is the relation between the tone and the noise responses. So this is tuning of electrical tuning at the soma of a neuron recorded at a relatively high sound level. So you have here a bit less than one octave width. This is it's the top of the tuning curve. So it has wide as it gets. What we did was to select two frequencies, one of them best frequency, in this case it was 17.2 kHz, and one of them that we call the tail frequency, the 17.2 kHz, and one of them a tail frequency, in this case it was 5.8 kHz, that evoked responses only at very loud levels, sound presentation levels. And what you see here the spines that were evoked, that were activated by the best frequency, the spines that were activated by the tail frequency, and the spines that were evoked by broadband noise. Okay. The thing is that this looks like the broadband noise is a superset of the tail and best frequency. So it looks like you have the frequencies which are tuned to best frequency. There's one widely tuned spine here that respond to both, one narrowly tuned spine here that respond only to the tail frequency. When you present noise, you get all of them. Okay, so this is again, this is a summary of this type of experiments. So noise always evokes most spikes, Some of them got evoked by the best frequencies, some by the tail frequencies, and a small number were evoked by both. Were activated by both. Okay, so what? First of all, this is the first demonstration of calcium signals from spines, okay, with actual identification. Okay, the input organization shows a lot of narrowly tuned spines, many of them narrower than the tuning of the mammal potential. I don't want to say narrower than the spikes, because we don't know what the tuning of the spikes is. We didn't measure them. Okay, the inputs are dense. That's different from visual cortex. And one thing that for me again was striking is the fact that it looks like spine numbers add up linearly with some level in the frequency bandwidth. Okay. Now there's a lot of caveats on that. First of all, we only saw calcium signals from NMDA currents. We need to know that the NMDA currents are actually distributed about equally as the AMPA currents. Otherwise, we really studied only a subset of the spine. Okay. Secondly, the input organization with a lot of narrowly tuned spines is consistent with visual cortex, and these inputs cannot come from other layer 2, 3. Okay, I have to be careful here. But they don't seem to come from other layer 2, 3 neurons. They would be too widely tuned in frequency. Okay, but we don't know, but they should be too widely tuned in frequency. You don't get a neuron that responds to a single frequency with half an octave in layer 2, 3. Or not many of them.
The neurons would be wider.
Yeah, the layer 2, 3 neurons would be wider than the spine. So the axon that gets to the spine presumably doesn't come from the layer 2, 3 neurons. Maybe these are actually direct thalamic fibers.
But there is a lot of connection between layer 2 to layer 2. Yeah. Where are all these connections?
Presumably they are the widely tuned spines.
The widely tuned.
Yeah, but the narrowly tuned, the most narrowly tuned spines cannot, presumably are not from layer 2, 3 neurons. Okay, the inputs are dense, so this seems to be different from visual cortex. But we should take into account that these are different techniques, and that they don't have yet enough data from visual cortex at this resolution. In fact, what you expect from visual cortex responses, if you believe their previous paper, is that they will usually not see any visual activation at the spines. Okay, and in fact, that's currently the status of the experiment. This issue of the spine number seems to add up linearly where mammal potential are definitely not linear. Okay, and this requires additional explanation, maybe inhibitory inputs, maybe some nonlinear integration synaptic charges, but this is something that requires explanation.
But do you see any inhibitory?
Not with this technique. No. No, not with these stimuli.
So, there is no.
No, we didn't see inhibitory inputs. There could be inhibitions that affect the, for example, if you have inhibition that comes at 0.8 of the amount of excitatory inputs, then you will not see it as inhibition, but it will still affect.
There is
an
inhibition with this technique because you don't want
yeah,
to
yeah.
I'm talking about the mental potential.
Okay. Before we continue, since I went far past my time, let me
but
show
you
this.
To talk about the somata frequency.
Yeah. This is what I showed here.
Not the width, the best.
Okay. So first of all, thank you.
Okay. Explain again.
This is electricity in the soma.
Okay, but what is the relation between the dendrite?
No, so the question was what would be the bandwidth of the tuning in the...
The question really is the best frequency per cell, some sort of an integral of the best frequency.
Yeah, what is that?
Yeah, so that's what seems to come out from these experiments. In these experiments, we used only two frequencies. One of them, the best frequency, one of them, far frequency.
Best means somata's best.
Yeah, the somata best frequency.
I see.
Okay, and what you see are more spines excited by the best frequency than by the tail frequency. Okay, this is a summary. Okay, so broadband noise always excites most spines. Some of them would be excited by the soma best frequency. A smaller number of them would be excited by the far frequency. Okay, and even smaller number is excited by both. Okay, so it looks like that there is, although there is a lot of heterogeneity at the spine level, okay, still, the majority of the spines would respond, would include the soma best frequency.
find spikes. You hypopolarize the cell soma to get rid of a cell spike.
Yeah.
But way out in the dendrite, shouldn't spines be spiking? And if they are, you should be able to get a calcium signal from the non-NMDA receptors.
Okay, so there are two camps in the world. One of them who believe in calcium spikes in the dendrites under natural conditions, and the other one who doesn't.
Well, voltage spikes, not calcium spikes.
Voltage spikes, yes. The Connaught lab doesn't believe in spine spikes. Okay, so... now, again, there's good evidence to the fact that all the spine data come from the NMDA receptor, that, as I showed you, when you put the blocker of the NMDA receptor, you don't get any more calcium data in the spine.
So that's good evidence for no electrical spikes in spines, unless the whole cell really is clamped.
Yeah, I mean, that's certainly the Connaught people would buy this.
So I don't understand
something.
You're talking all the time about science, but in fact, you're describing the properties of the treatment of the terminal.
Right.
The thing within the spine.
Right.
So the spines are just occupied to see the population.
Yeah. Correct. Okay, so the...
Aren't they silent for a long time after a thing was finished?
Yes.
And the other thing is that, if I understand correctly, the leaf neuron is responsible to smear every nice thing about the
Okay, so first of all, about your first question. The tendency in these experiments is to stimulate very slowly, every few seconds. Okay, so presumably the synapses recover from stimulus to stimulus. If you stimulate faster, we tried to bring up the stimulation rate. When we get to a stimulus per second, even relatively widely separated frequencies, the signal got completely lost. Okay? So, if you ask questions about the dynamics of the individual spine, there's a rich field of research here, which was not done in these experiments. But I think it's very interesting, it's very important, it's part of the thing that we are interested most in, okay, this type of adaptation of the individual input. Okay, it was not done in these experiments. With regard to music, I can just quote Larry Abbott, who once I gave a talk about different data about neurons in cat auditory cortex responses to natural sounds, and at the end of the talk he came to me and asked me, how do we hear with these neurons? Yeah, so... So they don't. They are sensitive to all of these. I mean, the more complicated answer would be that they are sensitive to all of these frequencies. They don't sound them indiscriminately. Okay, so this is not part of that study. Okay, but in our hands, when we the acoustic manipulation are finer, we can show that they are more interesting than just yeah.
Do you have the frequency tuning of the potential?
Of which potential?
The memory potential.
So yeah, well... Again, we have data that look like that. This is one sample. We recorded these things at the beginning of the experiment. While we were waiting for the neuron to fill up, we recorded the responses as a function of frequency and sound level. So we have the tuning.
Okay, so here it seems that there is a substantial tuning, if I can just keep on the colors. And in vision, again, the visual paper suggests that the tuning is very weak.
At the level of the memory potential of the soma. Yeah, this is true.
This is true, it means that the same is in auditory, or there are differences between auditory and vision?
If you will show this data to someone recording spikes from auditory cortex of mice or rats, then this would look reasonable. Okay, this is typical to what you get with spikes in auditory cortex of rodents.
And why in human is different?
In humans, it's much narrower. Already in cats, it's a bit narrower. In monkeys, it's a little bit narrower, too.
I'm talking about the modulation.
The fact that there's no responses here, large responses here, no responses exactly. here.
So here yeah. actually zero, but if you look at the corners, it's 10% modulation.
In the visual cortex.
In the visual cortex.
Yeah. No, but well, there are many ways of hand waving here, okay? The result is the result. One of them is that in terms of the... this tuning... tuned organization starts in the cochlea. Okay, it's not something that's computed in the higher areas like orientation tuning. Okay, it's actually narrower in the lower brain areas than in the cortex. Here it's widened. So it's about factor of three of what it would be more peripherally. Okay, so you compare it with the visual, I compare it with what it would have been in the inferior colliculus. Okay, so this is wide, not narrow. It's a species difference. I mean, one possibility, I don't know if it's true or not, but that's something I have on my mind now for a while, is the size of the cortex relative to the size of the dendritic tree. Okay, so the mouse, the whole range of 1 kHz to 100 kHz, takes half a millimeter of cortex. In humans, the same, the 100 hertz to 20 kilohertz is maybe a centimeter. Okay, so it's 20 times longer. And if the dendrites are about the same size, this is what people tell us, they are slightly longer in humans than in mice, but not that much longer, then the amount of input that they would integrate along the axis would much narrower in humans than in mice. This depends on the cochlea of the elephants as well, not only on the... it turns out that elephants don't hear well, but... but, yeah, I mean, this is the simplest way for me to conceptualize the difference between humans and mice in that aspect.
Okay.
Yeah? Okay, thank you.